Bonjour tout le monde, bienvenue dans Mercredi Startup. Nous allons attendre encore quelques secondes, une petite minute avant de commencer. Je suis donc Khatija Kassam, je suis conseillère aux communications pour Bonjour Startup et je vous accueille aujourd'hui exceptionnellement en personne. Je suis accompagnée de Kyle Boulet, qui est notre animateur comme toujours. Malheureusement, Amira Boutouchent, notre autre animateur, n'est pas en très bonne forme aujourd'hui et donc je la remplace pour animer cet événement. Alors aujourd'hui, on parle de leadership et de santé mentale. Donc on va avoir comme invité Anthony Vandramme et Camille de Poche et Fils qui ont donc mis en place la semaine de 4 jours pour leurs employés, ainsi que le docteur Hilary Lynn qui a une entreprise de coaching spécialisée en santé mentale, Curio. Voilà, alors bonjour Kyle, hello Kyle.
Bonjour Khatija, merci beaucoup for that very nice overview and for kind of setting things up so well. And it's obviously we wish Amira feels better, but it's very nice to have you here as well. And looking forward to the conversation today on a very important topic. Also, just wanted to take a minute and thank Bonjour Startup Montréal for giving us this platform, and also Cisco as well, our main sponsors. So obviously, as you mentioned, we're here today to discuss mental health within the context of startups, and we have some really great guests. But maybe we, before we kind of invite Anthony and Camille to get things started, and Hilary after that, Khatija would love to hear what your kind of thoughts are on this topic, and I know that you were excited to kind of bring this topic forward, why is this topic important to you?
Well, definitely over the past months, it's been a growing subject of interest for everyone with the pandemic that we had to face, each of us, entrepreneurs or not entrepreneurs. I mean, we've had to face a lockdown. We had to go through, working from home, not seeing our colleagues. So obviously, it had an impact on our mental health. And this is in addition for entrepreneurs to all the stress that you have to cope with during your normal day. I mean, I can't imagine how it is, and that's why it's an important subject that we wanted to address, especially when it comes to talking about leadership as a founder. It's as important to take care of your mental health as to secure financing for your company, because eventually your mental health can have impact on the success of your company.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know for one, I think that was really well put. Thank you for sharing. And I for one, it's an area that I'm extremely interested in, that I'm looking forward to getting the opportunity today to hear from people who I think know more about this than I do, so, and understand the meaning behind some of these buzz terms and buzzwords and different things happening in the space, and hear from some experts and some entrepreneurs. So with that in mind, why don't we invite Anthony and Camille from Poche et Fils to come up and join, and we can get things started.
Hi.
Hi. Hi, Anthony. Hi, Camille. So as I quickly mentioned before, and I will switch to French, j'ai donc lu et vu que chez Poche et Fils, pour comme solution justement à tous ces bouleversements que nous avons vécu ces derniers temps, vous avez décidé de mettre en place une mesure qui est quand même populaire, je pense, de plus en plus dans beaucoup d'organisations, la semaine de 4 jours. Alors, on aimerait bien en savoir plus sur, sur la genèse de ce projet. Comment en êtes-vous venu là? Est-ce que c'est en lien avec la pandémie? Racontez-nous tout.
Je pense que je vais laisser peut-être Camille répondre à ça parce que c'est une initiative qui a été l'idée est amenée par elle. Fait que je ne verrai pas. Vas-y.
Bonjour. En fait, c'est parti un peu du désir de l'équipe. On avait eu des demandes par rapport aux semaines de 4 jours. Puis aussi, nous, notre côté, on trouvait que c'est quand même une initiative qui était intéressante. On avait eu une super grosse année difficile, comme tout le monde en fait, en raison de la COVID. Puis on cherchait un peu des manières justement de rendre ça un peu plus léger puis de mettre le bien-être de tout le monde de l'avant. On s'est dit qu'on allait l'essayer parce qu'il n'y avait pas beaucoup de data là, sur. Surtout pour des petites entreprises. Si on voyait des grosses entreprises comme Microsoft au Japon qui l'avaient essayé et qui ça avait super bien été, mais à plus petite échelle comme Paul Schiffis, on avait, tu sais, on n'avait pas parlé à personne, puis il n'y avait pas beaucoup de monde qui le faisait. Donc, on s'est dit qu'on allait faire un projet pilote sur 3 mois pour un peu voir aussi partager avec les gens comment ils sont par rapport à ça et tout. Donc, on a commencé en juillet dernier. Ça coïncidait aussi avec un peu la fin du confinement, puis l'été et tout. Fait que c'était vraiment, vraiment cool d'avoir 4 jours cet été aussi. Puis ça s'est terminé le 1er octobre, donc ça fait quelques semaines, jours que c'est terminé, le projet pilote de 3 mois, puis on a décidé de poursuivre à l'année en fait, en semaine de 4 jours. Fait que c'est un peu le topo du projet.
Est-ce que vous avez développé une sorte d'étude auprès de vos employés pour voir un petit peu les effets que ça avait?
On a fait des sondages, donc 2 sondages durant le projet pilote de 3 mois. Ce qu'on se rend compte, c'est que c'est quand même assez difficile à mesurer parce que c'est comme les gens se sentent juste mieux. Puis ils disent, là, on voit que les gens voulaient vraiment continuer aussi puis que le projet se poursuive. Puis c'est ça. Bien, en fait, 100% des gens voulaient que ça continue puis se sentaient mieux là-dedans. C'est sûr qu'on voulait aussi regarder au niveau du stress par rapport à la gestion du temps. Fait que est-ce que le fait de devoir faire le même travail en 4 jours, ça viendrait augmenter le stress de chacun? Ça aussi, c'était à surveiller. Puis ce qu'on constate, c'est que parfois, ça peut être un élément un peu stressant, mais overall, c'était quand même assez bien géré là, dans l'équipe.
Et est-ce que vous considérez que le fait que vous soyez donc, on vous considère quand même comme une start-up avec et peut-être une équipe plus réduite que des plus grandes entreprises, est-ce que mettre en place une mesure comme celle-ci, c'était en termes d'activité, ça a dû peut-être avoir plus d'impact? Est-ce que vous recommandez à d'autres entreprises de votre taille ce genre de mesure?
Moi, je le recommanderais, mais en même temps, c'est propre à chaque entreprise puis à chaque employé. Là, fait que la première étape, ça serait de demander aux employés s'ils ont envie de ça. Puis, s'ils en ont envie, je pense que le fait de faire un projet pilote ou de le tester sur quelques mois, ça peut être quand même assez intéressant. Là. Puis aussi, pour les petites équipes, ce qui est le fun, c'est la proximité. Là, je pense que c'est super important dans un projet comme ça où... à l'écoute de comment les gens se sentent, puis de qu'est-ce qu'ils veulent vraiment, puis qu'est-ce qu'ils trouvent positif, négatif par rapport à ça. Fait que nous, ça nous a quand même aidé là, d'avoir cette espèce de proximité-là avec l'équipe. Après, je pense que c'est accessible aussi pour les grandes entreprises, considérant qu'il peut y avoir une certaine proximité entre les gestionnaires et les équipes.
Awesome. Effectivement. So, good teacher. Let's jump in and ask a question here, if it's okay. Sorry. Really interesting. Thank you. And I think Sarah asked a question in the chat that I've been waiting to ask. So I'll take this opportunity to ask it. Maybe before we do, I think most people know, but if you could just give like a very quick, you know, description of what your company does as well, maybe, and then also, you know, how do you think taking a step bigger, I think as a operator, I would be curious to know, like, so have you found a way of measuring kind of productivity or output and on a per day basis or versus like per week? And how have you kind of, what have you observed in terms of efficiency for the team since you've been doing this?
Pour la première partie de la question sur qu'est-ce que Poche et Fils, puis qu'est-ce qu'on fait, on fait les t-shirts à poche comme ça ici, pocket t-shirts, like you can go online and pick your t-shirt, the color, the size, and match it with your favorite pocket. So we have different design, sports, food, animals, everything. Ben ça, c'est en général, c'est quoi Poche et Fils. Puis après, au niveau opérationnel, sur qu'est-ce qui, comment on a pu mesurer ou voir l'avancée des projets. Moi, de mon point de vue, je suis convaincu que si tu donnes 32 heures à quelqu'un au lieu de 40 pour faire une tâche, on va trouver les moyens d'y arriver, puis on va couper... cut through the bullshit. Là. Des fois, on est dans un meeting qui s'étire, puis une fois qu'on... Je l'ai plus ressenti, là. OK, guys, c'est beau, on a fait le tour du sujet, go. OK, ben ici, j'ai peut-être pas de valeur ajoutée dans ce meeting-là, je vais aller faire autre chose. Je pense que ça, on le voit de plus en plus, mais précisément, je ne sais pas s'il y avait d'autres métriques qu'on a pu...
Mais on voulait vraiment avoir des métriques parce que c'est ça qui est fun à dire aussi mais la réalité, c'est que c'est quand même difficile de mesurer la productivité d'un travail qui n'est pas des unités produites ou c'est pas quantitatif. Puis même au feeling, je me dis, ah, peut-être que je vais le sentir, tu sais, qu'on est plus productif. Après, je pense qu'on prend les moyens pour être plus productif. Ça, je l'ai senti. Puis, mais au final, ce qu'on est vraiment capable de mesurer, c'est le bien-être des employés. Puis, on croit que quelqu'un qui est mieux va travailler mieux, donc va être plus productif. Fait que pour l'instant, après 3 mois de test, c'est ça la conclusion. Je ne pourrais pas aller mettre ma... Je ne suis pas assez confiante de dire, oh oui, notre productivité a augmenté de 25 % puis on est encore meilleur qu'on était avant. Ce que je sais, c'est qu'on ne livre pas moins de projets qu'on en livrait. Fait que probablement que ça a un peu augmenté. Mais je sais surtout que les gens sont mieux. Fait que je pense que c'est là un peu le succès du projet de pilote.
I love that. It's interesting. So from what I understand, it's like the one thing you're confident about is that your people are, you know, happier, more, you know, refreshed and that's very visible to you. So that's like a clear sort of output in terms of operations. I think it's normal to feel always that maybe things could maybe be more effective always at a company, whether you're working 4 days a week or 5 days a week, maybe, but it sounds like you're happy with the, you know, the output and, you know, the efficiency as is right now, plus your team is happier. So that's pretty special. That's cool. That's great. And I really would love to know, you know, you mentioned, you know, at the beginning, you know, there weren't a lot of examples in smaller businesses and stuff who had done this. And so, you know, where did you find the courage and what was making that decision like, you know, to try this without, you know, because I think a lot of people would point to that as a reason not to try something, right? You know, what was making that decision like and what were those discussions like, you know, amongst yourselves? And where did you find the courage to make that decision without a lot of data points telling you this was a clearly, great thing to do for your business?
I think me and Camille really enjoy playing golf, so we wanted a day off to go and play golf. Non, mais
that's a good reason.
Que... non, mais ben, en tout cas, pour ma part, j'ai pas eu beaucoup d'expérience en entreprise. Là, j'ai démarré Poche et Fils en sortant de l'université, fait que les normes ou les règles ou les conditions de travail plus fixes ou les cadres réguliers, je les connais moins. Fait que pour moi, c'est des questions qu'on peut adresser, puis tout est pas mal ouvert. Puis quand Camille elle a amené ça sur la table, c'était comme une discussion qui s'est passée assez rapidement. Hey, on aime ça pour nous, oui. Ben ça veut dire que peut-être d'autres gens aimeraient ça. On pose la question. La réponse est oui, on aimerait ça le tester. Puis go, on le fait. T'sais, ça n'a pas été tant que ça du... Mais Camille, elle a eu un super bon réflexe. Elle s'est entourée. Elle a posé des questions à des gens en RH qui avaient peut-être un peu plus les études derrière puis qui pouvaient un peu supporter nos hypothèses. Fait que, mais ça n'en a pas demandé bien, bien plus. Comme Cam a dit tantôt, le timing était bon pour l'essayer aussi. Le courage de l'essayer. Je sais pas, on est-tu courageux? Je sais pas.
Mais ça l'a pas... didn't feel courageux, là, mais c'était quand même naturel. Puis on s'est juste... Ah, oh, ça nous tente, on l'essaye, go. Puis on le fait de la bonne façon, là. Ça n'a pas été fait sur un coup de tête. C'est réfléchi, puis on en a parlé aux personnes... impliqué, mais...
En tout cas, vous l'avez utilisé aussi comme vraiment un avantage compétitif. On a vu que c'était sorti dans les médias, justement. Et donc, je me demandais, est-ce que ça a eu un effet aussi sur le recrutement et ça a peut-être attiré des gens à vouloir travailler avec vous?
C'est une bonne question. La première petite nuance, c'est que nous, on n'est jamais full à l'aise à mettre ça de l'avant, là, tout ce qui est marque employeur. Là, je pense qu'on n'est pas les meilleurs à le faire. On aime mieux quand ça, c'est pas nous qui parlent de nous, puis c'est d'autres gens qui en parlent, parce qu'on veut pas que ça soit juste un front. Là. Mais je pense que quand tu passes la porte ici, tu te rends compte que c'est vraiment ça, la culture qu'on a. Mais c'est drôle que tu poses la question maintenant parce qu'on était en entrevue pour un poste, une ouverture de poste aujourd'hui. Puis c'est la personne, clairement, que les semaines de 4 jours, c'était dans ses top arguments pour venir, pour postuler. Tu sais. Mais si on creuse plus loin que la semaine de 4 jours, qui devrait peut-être pas être la solution clé en main pour tout le monde, c'est plus l'ouverture des gestionnaires à rendre la conjugaison travail et vie privée plus facile. Tu sais, pour certains, ça va être des horaires flexibles. Pour d'autres, ça va être, je ne sais pas, n'importe quoi, un stationnement, un service de... Peu importe, là, l'outil ou le... C'est au fin du processus, c'est beaucoup plus l'ouverture puis l'écoute des gens. Là, puis je pense que Camille... elle a une super bonne écoute, puis elle va trouver les solutions pour que les gens se sentent bien.
Puis au niveau de le mettre de l'avant, en fait, on a quand même été surpris par... on a eu beaucoup de demandes d'entrevues, puis ça a rapidement pris de l'ampleur là, comme projet, puis les gens avaient des questions, parce que, un, je pense que les gens, ça leur tente de faire ça. Ou ils sont juste curieux des résultats aussi. Là. Fait que nous, ça nous fait vraiment plaisir de partager les résultats puis comment ça s'est passé. Puis même s'il y a des trucs qui sont un peu plus difficiles, si le projet avait, tu sais, si ça n'avait pas fonctionné, on en aurait parlé aussi. Ça aurait été correct. Là. Mais le but, c'était vraiment pas de faire de la presse là-dessus. Là. C'était vraiment, pour le bien-être de nous puis de l'équipe. Là.
Mais je pense que c'est significatif que la presse en ait parlé. C'est parce que vous êtes quand même une marque connue qui représente aussi le Québec. Et le fait que vous montriez que vous mettez une mesure quand même que beaucoup de gens ont, je pense, envie de mettre en place, mais qui ne sont pas sûrs de comment faire et si ça marche très bien, ça a été révélateur d'un besoin, je pense, plus large. Et justement, on reçoit quand même des questions dans notre chat sur des détails un peu plus techniques. Quelqu'un nous demande comment vous avez choisi quelle journée off mettre en place.
Mais ça aussi, on a posé la question, mais naturellement, c'est venu sur le vendredi pour avoir un long week-end. Des fois, tu vas avoir des activités le vendredi ou le jeudi soir, fait que de pouvoir te lever plus tard le vendredi, c'est cool. D'avoir juste une journée de plus pour faire l'épicerie ou ton lavage ou tout, ben c'était mieux. Fait que le vendredi, c'était un peu... c'était soit le lundi ou le vendredi, je pense qu'on hésitait pour juste faire un long week-end, mais le vendredi était...
Encore là, dans le projet pilote, c'était comme à tester, là. Puis une fois qu'on l'a testé, bon, le vendredi, ça marche aussi. Je pense que c'est ça, il y en a qui prennent, je pense à Flo, là, justement, la compagnie qui nous ont, la compagnie de ressources humaines qui nous ont accompagnés un peu pour ce projet-là. Eux, ils vont encore plus loin où la journée de congé est comme flexible. Puis il y en a qui préfèrent aussi prendre le lundi. dépendamment de la situation de chacun. Là. Nous, par contre, on trouvait ça quand même important que la journée qui soit prise soit tout le monde en même temps, la même journée. Fait qu'on est peut-être un peu moins flexible, mais c'est plus dur. Là. On a beaucoup d'interactions quand on travaille, fait qu'on préférait que ça soit tout le monde la même journée. Puis je pense qu'en ce moment, ça fonctionne bien.
Very cool, very cool. So it's interesting. Do you think that, like anytime you're going to work somewhere, obviously lifestyle is always part of the equation, right? So it sounds like some people are attracted to the lifestyle, and that's really interesting. And congratulations on all the interest around that and stuff. It's super cool. I had a question, you know, because you joked earlier about, you know, we like to play golf. So we just wanted the day off to play golf, right? And as much as that's a joke, I think it speaks to something, you know, relatively common that I observe in startup world and, you know, small business world, which is like, you know, it's when a leader doesn't personally relate to some of these trends or some of these things, then often sometimes maybe it sometimes feels like it takes longer, or they never kind of like, you know, recognize the benefits of that. And, you know, so sometimes it feels like the leaders of companies, you know, obviously make more money, they have lifestyles, whatever. So they might not relate to like certain requests or whatever from certain team members and stuff at times, or this kind of stuff. And so I am kind of just wondering, like, you know, how important do you think it was that this is a lifestyle that you wanted for yourselves, as well as, you know, something for that you thought might benefit, you know, the company's morale overall? Like, do you think that was a really important alignment, or do you think you could see companies adopting this even when the leaders were not as interested themselves maybe in this lifestyle?
Moi, je crois que ça a beaucoup plus d'impact qu'on peut le penser. Là. Ça part des decision makers, si on veut, là, sans se donner trop de crédit. Si on y croit, bien, au final, on va mettre en place les conditions pour que ça marche. C'est un peu un reflet des valeurs qu'on a. Puis ça peut être bon. C'est tant dans le bon que dans le moins bon. Là. Oui, nous, on n'est pas greedy, on ne cherche pas à se payer plus avant tout, on ne cherche pas à travailler moins, on cherche à être mieux. Mais aussi, de l'autre bord, on est très exigeant envers nous-mêmes. Puis ça, je pense que c'est sur le reste de l'équipe aussi. Fait que tant demander plus. Fait qu'il faut faire, c'est un couteau à deux tranchants, puis faut être conscient de de la puissance de ça, puis de comment on l'utilise. Ça dit que ça nous a-tu coupé? Ça dit que our internet connection is unstable.
Are we still there? On vous a perdu quelques secondes.
It was the best part.
Cool. Did you want Khatija, did you want them to repeat anything or are we good to continue?
We can continue. I was just saying that it's a sword that it can be good, or even in the less good thing, we have to be conscient que c'est un pouvoir qu'on a d'amener l'équipe dans une certaine direction. Mais ça, c'est cool une fois que tu t'en rends compte, parce que si tu veux rentrer d'autres valeurs ou d'autres comportements, ben ça part de nous autres.
Makes sense. Cool. And obviously, we've been spending, you know, 15 minutes here discussing the 4-day work week largely and all the implications. But what else have you found, you know, to be really important, you know, drivers of you know, the mental health and kind of mental fitness of people at your organization? Anything else that you kind of curious about, maybe experimenting with, or anything else you found to be effective?
Sure, tu parlais de d'autres choses qu'on fait.
Ouais.
Un truc qu'on fait depuis au plus qu'un an, c'est de commencer la semaine avec un tour de table sur comment on va. Tu sais, how are you really? Puis t'arrives, puis tu peux te montrer vulnérable, même si ça va pas bien. Il n'y a pas de bonne réponse ou de mauvaise réponse, c'est juste on t'accueille comme ça, puis maintenant tes collègues savent un peu mieux comment t'aborder durant la journée. parce que tu n'es pas juste la personne du service client ou la personne au marketing, tu es GF, tu as des passions, t'aimes tel truc, tu as des hobbies dans ta vie, tu as des challenges aussi dans ta vie personnelle, puis on t'accueille comme ça. Fait que ça, je trouve que c'est hyper simple, c'est une petite question, mais vraiment importante. Puis de créer un environnement où tu peux te montrer vulnérable, je pense que c'est très utile quand vient le temps d'adresser des discussions difficiles, quand vient le temps de prendre des risques, de ne pas te sentir jugé. Puis pour une entreprise qui est créative comme la nôtre, ben des fois de brainstormer puis de sortir quelque chose que ben, faut que tu sois à l'aise de le faire. Fait que ça, c'est une pratique que moi, je conseille à tout le monde, en fait, tu sais, de juste avoir les vraies discussions puis hey, comment ça va. Sinon, des trucs qu'on voudrait essayer, qu'on ne fait pas. On ne croit pas que ça part juste des beanbags et des tables de babyfoot, là, même si c'est cool.
Mais... Il y a aussi le télétravail, ça a été une question qu'on s'est posée beaucoup et qu'on se pose encore d'ailleurs. Parce qu'on trouve ça dur à appliquer dans le contexte de Poche et Fils, qui est une entreprise créative où on aime jouer, puis le jeu est vraiment important, puis la présence physique, puis tout. Fait que j'ai pas de réponse, là, mais je pense que le télétravail, c'est une question difficile, où après, on sait que pour l'équilibre puis la conciliation, c'est quand même très important pour certaines personnes. Mais d'un autre côté, pour la business, puis personnellement, on aime ça être en présentiel, donc c'est quand même un peu... c'est ça, c'est des questions qu'on se pose encore, puis on est ouvert à si des gens ont trouvé la formule magique sans imposer quoi que ce soit à personne, puis que ça fonctionne.
Effectivement, le télétravail, c'est encore un autre sujet qui a des impacts sur la santé mentale des employés, mais en tout cas... Merci, je pense qu'on va s'arrêter sur la semaine de 4 jours, mais en tout cas, on vous souhaite beaucoup de succès dans son application. J'en suis personnellement une supporter. juste pour préciser, on avait eu une question sur la gouvernance de Poche et Fils. Quelqu'un nous demandait, Anthony, tu es fondateur, Camille, tu es CEO. Est-ce que tu voulais rapidement répondre à cette question?
La réponse qui est...
Je veux dire par rapport à vos responsabilités respectives dans l'entreprise.
Ah ouais, ben écoutez, moi, maintenant je m'occupe plus de tout ce qui est créatif, contenu, c'est ça qui est ma force, mais c'est ça aussi qui m'anime le plus. Fait que je suis encore actionnaire de la compagnie puis impliqué dans l'alignement stratégique, mais... Camille, c'est la chef d'orchestre, c'est elle qui lead l'équipe, c'est elle qui s'assure que les équipes communiquent entre elles, qui ont les ressources nécessaires pour bien faire leur travail, qui sont au courant des priorités. Fait que c'est elle qui tranche au bout de la ligne, puis on y fait confiance. c'est tout.
She's the boss.
Ouais, exactement, oui.
OK. Bah, écoutez, merci pour ces précisions. Et puis, je vous invite à rester avec nous quand même quand on est avec Hilary. Je pense que ça va être intéressant également d'interagir encore sur des sujets. And I want to welcome now Hilary to the table. Hi, Hilary.
Hello, nice to meet you and so happy to be here with everybody.
Yes, you're joining us from New York or...
Yeah, I'm in New York City now. I was a long time California resident, but now I call New York City my true home. So, but.
All right. Well, awesome. I want to give Kyle the opportunity to present because he's the one who introduces us to you and to Curio.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Hilary, thank you so much for taking the time to join just maybe for a little bit. Context, Hilary and I met, I guess, a year ago now, roughly, through On Deck, which is another community for early stage startup events. And Hillary, maybe you could just give a little background on your journey and kind of, you know, where you are now, since I think it's relevant to the conversation and interesting.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And it wasn't a straightforward path. So I started off my career in academic medicine and very much deep in that world. I was doing research. I was preparing to, you know, go down the path of becoming an oncologist. And I was so frustrated, however, about how little a doctor can do to make a broader impact in healthcare and how traditional healthcare feels and is even today. I understand in Canada, you have a much more civilized healthcare system. And in America, it's a huge mess. It feels like a war sometimes to do the right thing for patients. So I found myself getting more interested in the startup world and started several early startups with ideas around, you know, preventive care, cancer screening, and eventually started Curio because my true passion is in the mental health realm. And to give a brief summary of what we focus on, and I'm sure we'll talk more about it, is we focus on the foundational emotional skills that help people build resilience and handle life challenges as they inevitably happen to us at Curio.
Oh. Wow. I think that's I'm inspired already. It's just, I think it's a really admirable mission and, you know, it's been really cool to watch, your journey, evolve. You know, maybe to start things off, it would be really interesting to hear your perspective on kind of the landscape of different things happening in the startup world around, you know, like like I mentioned in the early days, I think I was, or in the beginning of this conversation, I was looking forward to getting some clarification and definitions on the different buzzwords, you know, like mental health, mental fitness, mental stamina. Like, you know, it feels like sometimes people use like psychological safety and culture work and stuff around a lot of this stuff too. It's like, what do you see kind of happening out there, and how do you kind of map out the different kind of things happening in the space right now?
I think you're absolutely right. It's very confusing. So mental health, as it's understood by generally people, is more concerned with like mental illness by layperson speak. But the way I think of it is it's an umbrella term to describe everything from, you know, being severely ill and disabled to being, you know, burnout is covered, and so is, you know, stress and handling stress in general. So it's a huge spectrum. And I think we are in the world still figuring out the language around it. I also, you touched on psychological safety and culture. And I absolutely think that those realms are also mental health. And it's actually very, it's very interesting because most people consider it like a different topic. They consider it professional development, or like culture development, or HR even at companies. But really at the end of the day, we're talking about emotional skills, intelligence, and well-being. So the landscape out there now, starting from like mental health, like 1.0, I would say, is the primary folks who sort of try to solve the mental health landscape head on, looked at the deficiencies out there today with access to mental health care. So these are the companies that are trying to make it easier to access things like therapy or medications. So still very like traditional in a sense, they're just making the process easier to access traditional solutions for mental health. And really in these cases, it's solutions for mental illness.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Super cool. Thank you for painting that picture so clearly. So if that's kind of mental health 1.0, what is kind of like the next wave? What's mental health 2.0, so to speak, or what's kind of the next wave of things happening?
Yeah, it's like a really like a new and nascent frontier. And that is understanding mental health as a big spectrum of needs. So everything from the workplace to like mental wellness to mental illness, being under the entire umbrella. And that's where, you know, Curio sits. We we approach mental health and well-being from the side rather than straight on. So rather than like looking at today's solutions and being like, how do we make them better? We look at it as, okay, this is the entire field. And this is like what a human experience consists of. And what can we do to make that better? And so the way we approach it is, the main things about mental health today that are make it really hard are, it's not very tangible. You can't measure it the same way, you know, you go to a doctor and you take a blood test or, you know, weigh yourself. The second challenge is it's hard to normalize. And we're kind of having this conversation now, like no one really even understands what it is. So how do you like normalize it? There's a little bit of stigma and it's intimidating to approach it. And then the final thing is, even beyond access in terms of cost, it's the access of, I think of it as like messaging and branding. Like people don't feel like, you know, mental health is for me. A lot of times people are like, well, like, you know, I'm well, I don't need mental health help. So these three challenges are what we're addressing with what Curio is doing and some other new startups out there. They're also addressing it in these ways. So calling it emotional or mental fitness to make it seem more like something you do regularly to build up strength is some of what mental health 2.0 type companies are doing.
Super interesting. Yeah. And thank you so much for, I forgot to acknowledge the last question as well, just kind of clarifying, you know, some of this terminology and stuff for me. I feel like I'm now capable of having a much smarter conversation about this a lot more efficiently. So thank you. So obviously today's topic is kind of around, you know, it's mental health and leadership also. And so, you know, even, you know, you just use the word kind of like mental fitness, which almost makes me feel like makes me envision like, you know, going to the gym, but like in my mind to some extent. And so, you know, obviously there's a performance aspect of that. And when we talk about leadership, it's hard to separate, you know, performance and these kinds of things. And so, you know, how do you think all these pieces fit together in terms of building a high performance culture at an organization?
Yeah, I love the analogies to physical fitness. My co-founder is an athlete, and we derive a lot of analogies from the physical fitness world. So on that thread, leadership in like a company or really in any structure like politics is analogous to being a professional athlete, let's just say. And to get to that point, you have to perfect so many aspects. Like in physical fitness, you have to work out in a very specific way, like every single day. And, you know, you think about the food you put into your body and you sleep well in order to like prime yourself to be physically fit as possible. So for leadership, I think of that high level of emotional performance as the same thing. You're a professional, you're performing at the highest level. So what you need to do is, you know, same foundational, eating right and sleeping right. But then the more emotional pieces are, you know, surrounding yourself with the people you need for support. And then the equivalent of the physical exercises you do, which would be emotional exercises. We do this more, and it's a little bit more unusual to talk about in terms of like, we do like emotional reps and exercises in Curio, but more generally in real life, you can imagine it as every time you encounter a stressful situation and then you handle it, that is like a rep. And if you handle it in such a way that, you know, you figure out something or your body gets used to it, your mind gets used to it, then you become stronger. And it matters actually like how big that challenge is at that time, how quickly it happened, and then how you process or you deal with it. So to make that more tangible, people who are traumatized, trauma is when you have too big of a challenge or stressor happening when your mind or emotions are not ready. And then it's very hard to recover from that because, you know, it's like getting, it's like trying to pick up like a car, let's just say, if you haven't been training up to do that, it's too much. You'll injure yourself. You'll be hurt. And it's hard to recover from. But if you introduce small challenges at a level that you are ready for, and you keep practicing and you get better and you process it properly, then you will be strong enough to handle much bigger stresses and challenges as they happen.
I love that. That's so interesting and inspirational, and it sounds so tight and like, you know, bite-sized. I've never heard anybody be able to kind of take some of the mental health you know, challenges and kind of exercises and make it sound so tangible. So super interesting. You know, you mentioned, you know, how you process it and deal with it, deal with you know, unexpected events or stressors is a part of I forget my exact question, but I think what I'm interested in knowing is, I guess some people from my experience just seem to kind of say like, hey, well, one way or another, it's going to happen. It's just going to happen. And it's like, you know, it doesn't matter how, like what happens, you'll get over it kind of over time, you know? And so I guess what I'm wondering is like, you know, and if you, you know, if you insist on trying to lift the car when you're not capable of it and you, you know, you hurt yourself physically, it's pretty obvious, right? It's very tangible. But sometimes I feel like, you know, with when it comes to mental health and these kinds of things, sometimes those things, it's not clear to people that there's like a clear kind of negative like fallout or like consequence or like injury, you know, related to kind of maybe not being prepared to live through some of those things. And so, yeah, how do you think about sort of that qualitative aspect to you know, assessing how would one think about assessing, you know, the impact of not being prepared to kind of to lift that car, you know, psychologically? Yeah. I'm just curious. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the pandemic was a great like example of that. I think nobody was prepared for that to happen, and the emotional impact of having to adjust to a completely different lifestyle. And I saw that in my practice. I still do some telemedicine, and about half of my patients I see for mental health concerns. So basically, there are still ways to recover. Some people need a lot longer of a rest period or support period. And that's the kind of period when you need to really go back to the basics. Sometimes people do need medications to patch that or bridge that gap. And, you know, seeing a crisis therapist or counselor is appropriate for really severe emotional trauma or injury. And other people, they just feel like, you know, moderately injured, so to speak. And in that case, you can go back to the basics. And again, it's like all of the doing the things that make you happy in a healthy way. So not resorting to dangerous things like substances. And a lot of people did do this during the pandemic. Like a lot of people were like drinking alcohol. They were like, you know, at the very least, like we all suffered a little bit of like eating our emotions during the pandemic. And so these are like the less healthy ways of dealing with the stress. And the healthier ways are going back to the foundations of like sleeping well, eating well, and socializing. Like people don't think about that, but humans need, no matter how introverted you are, humans need social interaction and stimulation. It's something we see from the very earliest ages. So going back to those fundamentals are the first part of recovering from a big stress like that.
Super cool, super interesting. Thank you for sharing. So I don't know, I know you mentioned that you, you know, earlier that you're French, you know, you studied some French in high school, so you were, you know, you get capturing some stuff. I'm not sure how much you made out of the past conversation, but obviously parts of it were in English, but, you know, they were clearly talking about, you know, a lot about the their experience piloting like the 4-day work week and some of these things. And so what is your, you know, what's your perspective on, you know, the role organizations have to play and, you know, what you're seeing kind of the best practices, what are the most progressive companies doing today to support the mental health of their employees?
Yeah, I think it all comes down to an intrinsic effort and motivation. And what I mean by that is we're seeing now in a remote world that you have to trust your employees and your workers and your teammates to do the right thing for, you know, both themselves and the company. And so that initial piece of like hiring the right person suddenly becomes so much more important. There's almost no amount of surveillance that will allow you to like make someone work more effectively. Like I know some really draconian companies out there will literally record like keystrokes or like just to see like when you're active on your computer. And to me, it's a little bit besides the point, because yes, you can demand that a worker works a certain number of hours or is present for a certain number of hours in a day, but you don't end up getting like true effective work out of that. So it's all about working smart rather than working hard or number of hours. So the most progressive ideas I've seen is having a set number of vacation days that are defined. It turns out like if you give everyone infinite vacation days, it doesn't work out because everyone always tries to one up their teammates and take fewer vacation days. But having like a very generous amount of paid time off that is almost like you make people take it so that they are forced to take that time to help themselves and recover from the work. That is really generous. I think the 4-day work week is fascinating to me. I think it's when it's possible, I think it works. I know there are challenges that some teams are facing around that. Like, do you line up the 4 days? Like, are they more flexible over a 5-day period? So I think logistically it can be complicated, but it depending on your particular company's needs, it can work really well.
Super cool. Thank you for sharing. And can you tell us a little bit more about Curio's journey and kind of where you're at? And is this something that's open to the public? Can we all go try it after this if we like? Tell us a little bit more about that.
Sure. And Curio has been quite a journey. And the reason is like I started it in the pandemic and responding to the needs of people during a pandemic that has never been seen before requires you to be very agile. So in the beginning, people were much more geared towards needing support, and that's what we offered in the early pandemic. And then as the pandemic moved onwards, people started suffering from, honestly, boredom, because we were all locked down, didn't have a lot of stimulation socially. And so we turned almost towards a more humorous entertainment slant of mental well-being. And today, what we have done with all of our learnings is we've created much more of an exercise analogous product. So the best analogy you can think of is Peloton. So we have the live sessions, which are, you know, like Peloton, we do live sessions, we do on-demand products, and we do also metrics measurement. So like Peloton, it helps you measure like how much you've ridden your bike. We help you measure, you know, how many reps at what level depth you've done in terms of emotional reps. And we also are designing out some really interesting new metrics that are based on validated measurements out there. So we traditional psychology is very difficult to measure in real life scenarios. So we're adapting them to create something we call the functional threshold resilience metric. And what that means is like how much of a challenge can you stand in a particular field or topic? And you know, how much, what can you do in order to improve that? So today we are still in beta, and yet we're taking applications for our next launch. We'll be focusing on burnout for the next phase. So I highly encourage everybody to go to our website, which is joincurio.com, and you can sign up there, and we'll let you know once we open that next phase, which should be in the next month.
Super cool. Thank you.
I was curious to know more about the people who you work with. I mean, your clients. Obviously, there are people from various industries with various levels of leadership as well. Have you worked with entrepreneurs or founders? And I mean, how specific, how different is the way you work with them compared to others?
Yeah. It's, we do, our broader target audience are knowledge workers. We're people who are professionals in fields, usually tech companies, but also other knowledge workers. And we do have a lot of founders. And I think other than other than the obvious, which is that founders face incredible stresses through the journey, is that founders have to be so creative about how they manage everything, either in their company or in their own lives. You have to design your life in a way that many other people don't, like when they're not an entrepreneur. So we do have a lot of founders as well.
And how different, I mean, what's the challenge when you have to talk about mental health with them, or how to cope with their, and to not like to care about their own mental health? Because I know that, I mean, they are result oriented because they have to survive in a very competitive environment. So how do you speak to them more specifically?
Yeah, our entire company is structured so differently, branding and messaging wise, and in our design itself, from traditional methods. And it's actually probably the approach that most founders would prefer. And what I mean is, rather than focusing simply on support, we got lots of feedback that people, like you said, are much more geared towards actions and outcomes. So that's why we actually, in our sessions, they're actual exercises that you have an output with, that you can act on. And that's why we focus on these metrics as well. And it's very much based on our own lived experiences, as well as those of our earliest users, because they've said, like, you know, therapists out there or whatever other solutions they've tried has like a certain tone to it, which doesn't feel quite right for a very action-oriented founder type of a person.
Thanks, that's very interesting. Kyle, did you want to add something?
No, I'm just, you know, wishing that I had done this prior to my car breaking down on my way to my grandma's funeral yesterday and me trying to, you know, figure it all out. I'm sure this would help. No, I'm just teasing. But you know, it seems like really valuable work to do and really, really interesting insights. And I just want to thank you so much for taking the time to join Hillary. And you know, one thing I'm just kind of curious about, obviously, you know, you've come on here and we've been asking you questions. But I'm curious if there's anything that we haven't asked, anything that you want to kind of use this platform for, something you wish we had asked that we hadn't asked, you know, about the, you know, the space, anything you want to kind of volunteer or share that you'd like to put out there?
Yeah, I think you asked mainly the important things, but the final message I would say is like, a lot of people wonder if they should care about mental health, or if it's like right for them, or if therapy is right for them. And I would never like say that everybody needs quote unquote therapy or traditional mental health solutions if it doesn't feel right for them. But I do think what's important for everybody is emotional processing and learning how to deal with emotional challenges and building up emotional strength. And that can take form in so many different ways. So whatever feels right for you and anyone who's listening out there, just make a note that, you know, emotional processing is actually an important part of life that we do every single day with every single act that happens.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Khatija, is there anything else you wanted to add?
No, I think it was very insightful. And I think we had two very different ways of addressing the subject of mental health, because we had first a very concrete example of measures taken in a work environment by an actual company, and then we had this more let's say first theoretical approach, and then more into the emotional aspect of taking care of your mental health, and I think it's a good wrap up of the message for our entrepreneurs, which is to, you know, think about the business aspects of taking care of your mental health, but also to take care of yourself like you would take care of your body, right, Hillary?
Yeah, absolutely. It's mind and body are intertwined. So, yeah. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for being with us. And Kyle, I think we can tell our audience that we're going to see them next month on November 10th. And we will speak all again about leadership, but we will focus on leadership and governance this time. So obviously all subjects are very intertwined, but we'll be happy to focus on that. I would also like to thank our partners for Mercredi Startup, Cisco Design. And I hope our co-host, Amira, will feel better to join us next month. And Kyle, thank you for being with us. And thank you, Anthony, Camille, and Hilary. Thank you, Anthony.
Thank you. Thank you for having us. All right, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
See you soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.